Remember, we still have our goal, so I erased everything except the goal we are going for. We still want to introduce an interesting vector space, but before we do that, we need the concept of supremum, which again is something that those of you who had Mathematics 3 already know. So I will just give it as a formal definition. So we consider a subset of the real line. So E is just a set of real numbers. So you can make a little picture for yourself. You can think about having the real numbers on an axis. So we have a set. Nobody says that this is just an interval. So it might be that we have some numbers here, and we have some numbers here, and let's say we have some numbers here. So E is just the union of these small intervals in this case. So we say that such a set is bounded above bounded above means that the elements of the set do not just continue going all the way to infinity, but that they actually stop at a certain time. So formulated mathematically, this means that there exists a certain number beta with the property that for all elements x in the set, they are smaller than or equal to the beta. And if you look at the example we have here, you can see that the elements in E, they somehow stop here. So you can take any beta that is larger. You could take, for example, a beta that is placed here. This beta is something that is larger than all the elements in the set E. If a set is bounded above, we will introduce the so-called supremum. So the supremum over E, this will denote the smallest beta that is larger than all x. So this means that for the case we have here, then the supremum is actually exactly the last element we have here. So instead of writing supremum all the time, we will have a short name, so we'll just denote it by sup e. So if we use this notation, then what we have here is the sup e. It turns out to be very convenient also to use the notation of supremum for sets that are not bounded above. And if they are not bounded above, we'll just put the supremum equal to infinity. So, if it is not bounded above, we take supremum E and we just define it to be infinite. So this means that if there are just elements in E that just continue outside here, then the smallest beta that is bigger than all of them, this will be infinity. So therefore we put the supremum equal to infinity. Actually, we don't really want to speak just about sets. We want to consider functions. So let's consider a function. So this means we take an f that is going from some set A, and at the moment we want it to have real values. So it goes into R. So you can make a small picture in your mind. I can also make a small picture here. So what it means is, we have a set, let's just say that this is the set A, This is the interval we are speaking about here. And then we look at a function defined on this interval. So this could be something that goes like this, and it could be, for example, that it continues like this. So this is the function if. And then we consider E. The set we really want to look at is the set of all functions values f of x, where x belongs to A. So this is what you already in high school called the range of the function f, billedmængden. So what is this on the figure we have here? You can see there's a part of the range that is sitting here. So if I do the same as I did above here, I can just scratch it like this. And then we also have a part of the range that is going here. This is corresponding to this piece. So these two sets together corresponds to E. So now, if you want to write it down, supremum over E, what does this mean? This means that we are taking supremum over all functions value f of x, where x belongs to the set A. Sometimes there exists an x. Sometimes you can find an x here such that the function value of this x is exactly equal to this supremum's value. So the supremum's value is the one we have here. So sometimes you can find an x0 so with the property that f calculated in x0 is exactly equal to this maximum value. So for example, you can see you have an increasing function here. So if a is actually the interval, the closed interval, then you can see that there's a function value up here. And this means that exactly this x0 will actually be mapped onto the supremum value. So there exists an x0 such that f of x0 is equal to the supremum of f of x, where x belongs to A. If this is the case, then you know that you actually have a maximum value for your function. So instead of speaking about supremum, you can as well just speak about maximum value like you did in high school. So we speak about maximum rather than supremum. And we also say that the supremum value is attained. So this sounds very abstract, but this is much easier to understand if you look at a concrete example. So let's make a small example. So let's take an elementary function. Let's take f of x equal to, let's just take minus x to the power 2 plus 2x. And now be careful with the domain I choose. So I say, let's look at this function for x values belonging to the interval from 0 up to 3. So you see, 0 is contained, 3 is not contained. So you can write this in a different way. You can write it as x times 2 minus x. So how does this function look like? So you can see here, this is a parabola. And it's going down, and it is 0 here, and it is 0 again at 2. This is what you see here. It is 0 at x equal to 0, and this is 0 again at x equal to 2. So you know how it looked like. It goes like this, and then it goes down like this. And if you say 3 is here, then it is open here. So if you look at this function, you can see that the supremum value, that's the one you have here. And because this is symmetric, exactly the x value, x equal to 1, is the one that gets mapped into the supremum value. So the supremum value is attained. And what you can say is that the max of all values f of x, where x belongs in the interval 0 to 3, this is exactly the function's value f of 1. And if you look at it, if you put in x equals 1, you can see you get 1 times 1, so you get 1. Do any of you have an idea how we can make a small modification of this function such that we end up with something where the maximum value is not attained? Can you change this in an easy way to get an example where it is not the case? Alexandra?
If you put a minus.
If you flip it, simply. So if you take, if you continue the example, f of x, and by flipping it, you get x to the power 2 minus 2x. And again, x from 0 to 3. Then you see, you get exactly the same, but now it goes like this, and then it goes up like this. And because the endpoint 3 is not contained in the interval, you see, because I kept it open all the time, then you see that you just get function values that are getting arbitrarily close to this value, but you do not attain it. There is no x that get mapped into the function value that you have here. So the maximum does not exist. We have a supremum, but the supremum is not attained. So the conclusion here is that sometimes the supremum is attained, sometimes it is not. And this motivates the next theorem, because this tells us that if you look at continuous functions that are defined on closed intervals, bounded closed intervals, then the supremum is always attained. So I want to write it down very detailed. So let's say that the interval A, B, if you write it down like this, and you put the brackets like this, then somehow from the mathematical notation, it is clear that we are speaking about a bounded closed interval. It is an interval starting with a certain x value and ending at another x value. If the interval went all the way to infinity, we would not close the brackets like this, then one of them would be open. So already from the notation, it is clear that this is a bounded closed interval, but I want to write it anyway. The theorem tells us that any continuous function on a closed bounded interval will attain its maximum. Any continuous function, so a function f that goes from the interval a, b into the real numbers, it attains its supremum. And let me just repeat what it means. This means, and then I just repeat what we had already on the board, so this means that there exists an x0 belonging to the interval a, b, such that the function value f of x0 is the same as the supremum over all f of x, where x now belongs to the interval a, b. And if you make a small figure, you'll see that no matter how you look at this interval and you try to make a continuous function, then you can see that this theorem actually fits with the intuition you get of making a small figure. So this corresponds to what you would believe yourself. Now we are close to this space that we want to look at. So we will define it here. So now we are finally reaching the goal that was stated here. So let me put two bars, because finally we arrived there. So we will consider a space that has the notation C, and then we put a bracket A, B. And the definition of this space will simply be that this consists of all continuous functions on this interval AB. So we are speaking about all functions F going from A to B into, and now you need to pay attention to the details, because there's a small change here. You see, so far up here, I always considered functions that take real values. Of course, in real life, we are mostly interested in functions that take real values. But for the space we're looking at here, we actually allow functions that take complex values. This means, for example, the function could be the complex exponential functions, which we already saw in this definition of trigonometric polynomials. So we know this is an important function. So here, we actually consider functions from this interval into the complex numbers. And the only condition we put is to say that f should be continuous. What we want to prove now is stated as an example in the book. And actually, I don't know why I stated it as an example, because it is a mathematical theorem. But for some reason, I thought that this was also an example. It was an application of the theory. So I decided to state it as an example. So what it says is that this space, this is actually a vector space. And we can define a norm on the space. And the way we define the norm, you see, the notation I used so far was just to take these double bars and then we put in the element from the space. Now, in the abstract theory, we use the V to denote the elements in the space. Now we are speaking about a space consisting of functions. So I'll just put in an F instead. So this would be our standard notation for the norm. However, you know, you will be dealing with many norms in this course. So therefore, there are some of the norms that we will use repeatedly, and it is very convenient to have a special name for them. And for this reason, since this is one of them we will use all the time, it has a special name, so we put a small infinity down there. So the name of this norm is actually the infinity norm or the supremum norm. And the way this is defined is that we simply take the maximum function value f of x for which x belongs to the interval AB. So we need to check that this actually gives us a norm. So now we can erase the goal. So let's just remind ourselves, what did it mean to have a norm? So from the abstract theory, that meant you had a vector space V, and then a norm should be a mapping that goes from the space into real numbers, and then we had these three properties. One of them, the norm, should always be positive. The norm should be zero, if and only if the element is zero. And the norm of an alpha times V should be the same as alpha absolute value times the norm of V. And the last one was that the norm of V plus W should be smaller than or equal to norm V plus norm W. These are the properties that we have to check. So I would like to hear, what is your opinion about this? You see, this is a little bit dangerous the way it is formulated in the book. It is formulated the same way in all books about this topic, actually, but it is a little bit dangerous because it looked like you have just three conditions, but actually you have four conditions because you have to check that the norm is a mapping going from the vector space into the real numbers. So that means in the case we are dealing with here, we need to check that this norm that we denote with the infinite symbol below, that this is actually a mapping that goes from the space CAB into the real numbers. So in other words, can any of you tell me and tell anybody else, how can we be sure that this maximum actually gives us a finite value? You see, it is a maximum over a lot of positive numbers. So it can be finite or in principle it could be infinite. How can we be sure that this is finite? So what do you apply now?
I'm applying the fact that when I have a continuous function mapping a compact into a compact set, so I think that the maximum is an infinity.
So in other words, you are applying the theorem. You're applying the theorem saying that any continuous function from an interval a, b into R, it attains its supremum value. So this supremum value, which in principle could be infinite, we know from this theorem that this is not infinite because there exists an x0 such that the function value is exactly equal to the supremum. And function values are, by definition, real numbers or maybe complex numbers. In this setting of real functions, of course, what comes out here is a real number. So that means this theorem tells us that the supremum, this is a real maximum value, that means it is a real number. So this is a consequence. It's completely correct what you say. This is a consequence of theorem 163. So if any of you have some questions about this, again, ask me at the problem session, and then I'll be happy to give more details about that. But as I say, it's completely correct what you say. Now, we have to check these properties. So let's do it in all details. So we want to check that the norm of F, that this is positive in the sense that it is zero or greater than zero. So can we be sure that this is correct? The answer is again yes, because, I mean, where do we have it? It is defined by the maximum value over some positive or zero numbers, so therefore this must be satisfied as well. So this condition is okay by definition. Now we need to check this. And this is an implication that goes both ways. So the way to do that is first to take one implication and then take the other one. So let's start from here first. So let's assume that F is equal to zero. What does it mean that F is equal to zero? This means that we are dealing with a function which function's values all are equal to zero. So the definition of just writing f equal to zero means that f of x is zero for all x in AB. And if all these values are zero, then what we are dealing with, f in norm, which is defined as the maximum value of f of x in absolute value, if all of these numbers are equal to zero, and we then take the maximum value, this must again be zero. This is just maximum of a lot of zeros. So this is again zero. So what this says is that if f is zero, then the norm is also zero. So this proves somehow to get from here to here. Let's prove the other way. So if f in infinity norm is equal to zero, then we need to put in what does this norm means, but the definition of this norm is that this is the maximum value of the absolute values of f of x. So this means max f of x, x in a, b is equal to zero. But if the max of these numbers, note that all of them are non-negative, all of them are either zero or positive. So if the maximum of them is equal to zero, then all of them need to be zero. So this means f of x in absolute value is zero for all x. And if the absolute value of f of x is equal to zero, then the function itself must be equal to zero. So that means now we can come from here, and then we can come to here. So this proves this property. Now we have to prove two, and we have to prove three. So for the proof of two, we have to look at some alpha type f, and then we take what we would like to call the infinity norm of this. So we want to show that the alpha can just go out with an absolute value. So again, we have to use the definition of this. So the definition is that we need to take the maximum of the function we're dealing with. Now we're dealing with the function alpha times f. That means we take maximum of alpha times f of x, where x belongs to a, b. But the maximum of a function f of x that is just multiplied with a number alpha, this is just the same as the maximum for the function itself times the absolute value of alpha. So this is the same as alpha times the maximum value f of x, x in the interval a, b. And if you're looking at this, this is exactly alpha in absolute value. This is exactly the infinity norm of f. So this proves that 2 is also satisfied. So now we are left with the third property. So I want to do that in a lot of details. Again, so what we have to prove I have already stated it here, but let's write down what this means. So we have to prove that the norm of f plus g, again, the special norm that we denote by the infinity norm, we must show that this is smaller than or equal to norm f plus norm g. And let me write down exactly what this means, because if you look at it this way, it is actually not that easy to understand. So if you just write down the definitions, what this says is we want to prove that the maximum of, I mean, what is this? This is the maximum of functions values f of x plus g of x, where x belongs to the interval a, b. This is what we have here. We need to show that this is smaller than, and this is the maximum value of f. And this is the maximum value of g. I don't know how you look at it, but I think this is too complicated. I mean, this is too complicated to deal with all these maximum at the same time. So maybe you think this means that I give up and I let you go out, but this is not what I'm on the way to say. What I will say to you is you need to simplify this before you start to prove anything. So what I want to do is first show what you want without putting the maximum. And then if you can show that all the numbers you have here are smaller than what you have on this side. Then after that, you can put the maximum on that side. So my suggestion is that we first work on f of x plus g of x, so without using the maximum. So let's see how you can use this idea. This is somehow an idea that you can use many times in Mathematics 4, and you can use it in any kind of engineering as well, that you have to show something that is actually complicated. So instead of working with these complicated symbols right away, try to simplify it. Try to extract something where you can do some easier calculations and then stepwise move towards this more complicated thing. This is exactly what we'll do here. And you will see that this works very well, because if you forget about this maximum, if you remove this maximum and you just work on what we have here, then there are a lot of manipulations that you can do without thinking too much about it. Do any of you have an idea how can we manipulate on this to get something that will look a little bit like this? You should think about it in the sense that what you're dealing with here is just the absolute value that you know. F of x and g of x, they are just complex numbers. So all the manipulations you know from the real numbers and the complex numbers, you can apply it here. Alexandra?
We can use the triangle inequality just with the norm.
We can use the triangle inequality just on the absolute value. So then you say this is smaller than or equal to?
The absolute value of f of x plus the absolute value.
Yes, exactly. This holds for all values of x. This is just the triangle inequality in the real numbers or the complex numbers. And what you see here is f of x, this is just one function value for our function f. This function value is certainly smaller than or equal to the maximum value. So this is certainly smaller than or equal to the maximum value over all function values. So that means just this one by itself is certainly smaller than or equal to the maximum of f of x, where x is in AB. And in the same sense, g of x, this is just one function value for g. This is certainly smaller than or equal to the maximum value. So what you see here is that no matter which x values you consider, then f of x plus g of x in absolute value will be smaller than or equal to this fixed number. So that means, since all of these numbers are smaller than or equal to what you have here, whenever you take the maximum value of these, it will still be smaller than this value you have here. I could put some text saying this holds for all x. And therefore, since it holds for all of them, it holds for the maximum. So therefore, we can put max of f of x plus g of x, x in AB. This is then smaller than or equal to. And then I repeat everything that is stated here. And if you look at it, this is exactly what we had to prove here. So we stated the way we have to prove this, and we just reformulated this in this way. So that means, finally now, we have proved all the properties for a norm. Yes, what is your question?
You are consistent in the writing of the interval for x. If we miss that in one of our home assignments, is that a big deal?
In which sense?
Will it count down on the grades?
So you did not put, you did not deliver any homework in this course yet. But you mean if you do it?
Yeah.
Please try to say your question again, because
we are going to have some home assignments.
Yes,
right?
Yes.
And if we, in those home assignments, are going to miss, for example, one or two places where we forgot to write the interval of x,
I see.
Will it count down?
Not too much, because I think from the context, it will be clear which interval you're dealing with. I cannot think about any homework assignment where you will have to change the interval so there can be conflicts. If you look at a certain exercise, it will deal with one interval, and therefore it will be clear. So therefore, whether you put this or not, this should not be a big deal for us. So that should be okay. Do you have any other questions? Because if not, then I will apply this base and speak about convergence. You know, I put this definition of convergence. We did not use it for anything yet, but let's try to do it with the space we have now. So I actually take an example that is stated in the book now. And the example heavily uses some knowledge that most of you have from the course Mathematics 2. If any of you haven't had Mathematics 2 and you don't know exactly the background for this example, then just tell me and then I will provide the details for that example. So what we're doing here is to consider some functions. So I will look at a function that is called fk of x, and the way I define it is as a finite sum from n equal to 0 up to k of x to the power k. And those of you who just completed Mathematics 2 will remember that we spent a lot of time on this expression, and you actually proved that this is the same as, actually, this should be an n. This is the same as 1 minus x to the power k plus 1 divided by 1 minus x. So you can do some manipulations on this, and you can show this is the same as this expression. And in Mathematics 2, we always looked at this expression for x belonging to the open interval from minus 1 to 1. Of course, you are interested to see what happens when you let k tend to infinity. So we will also look at f of x, which is then the sum from n equal to 0 up to infinity, x to the power, why did I call it n? It should be n k, x to the power k. And we did that in Mathematics 2, and you saw that this is the same as 1 divided by 1 minus x. And again, we look at this for x belonging to minus 1 to 1. Now, you see, there's a small problem if you want to combine this with what we just discussed. Because if you look at the definition of our space, which I thought I had somewhere, but it seems that I removed it. So you know, we always looked at C, A, B, which is then the set of functions from A, B into C, for which F is continuous. This is the space we have been dealing with. And we just showed in our long example that we have a norm on this space. But you see, in this space, we used actually that the functions are defined on a closed interval. So see here we have a different set, because the natural set is somehow the open interval from minus 1 to 1, which does not fit with what we're doing here. So we'll do a small modification. And the modification will be that we consider a smaller interval. So these functions f and fk, you agree with me, all of these functions are continuous. They are even continuous on this open interval from minus 1 to 1. But this means that they are also continuous on any smaller interval. So this means all these functions, f and fk, they belong to the set of continuous functions on, and then I'll simply put in a closed interval that is contained in this interval from minus 1 to 1. And you can pick exactly the interval you want to. I just choose to look at the interval from 0 to 1/2. So this statement f and fk belongs to c 0, 1/2. This simply means that these two functions, this function and this function, they are continuous functions on the interval from 0 up to 1/2. Now, we just proved that this space has a norm. Namely, the norm of f equal to the max of f of x, where x belongs to, and now we put in the exact values for a and b, so this is 0 to 1/2. So the question is, fk is a sequence of functions. And you know, the way you thought about it in Mathematics 2 is that this partial sum actually converts to this. This is completely true in the sense that if you put in any x value, then what comes out here will converge to what we have now, what we have here. But now the question is, does it happen also in the sense of the norm? So will fk converge to f in the space c 0 up to 1/2? That means, if you think about how did I define that a sequence in a norm space converts to something, the way we defined it was to say that we look at the difference between f and fk and we want it to converge to 0 in the sense of the norm. So that means we need to check if f minus fk measured in this infinity norm, whether this goes to 0 or not. This is the question, and this is the last question we'll deal with today. So again, the starting point when you want to do something in mathematics, it is always to look at the definition. So we want to check whether this one goes to 0. What does this mean? This means we must check whether, and then we have to put in the definition of this. So we must check whether the maximum of f of x minus fk of x, where x belongs to ab, whether this actually goes to 0 for k tending to infinity. And now I can just repeat myself and say, I think this is too complicated. I think it is too complicated to have to deal with the function values and then to deal with the maximum at the same time. I think we should worry about what is inside here. Let's calculate f of x minus fk of x. And then after doing that, take the maximum. So let's do that. So we start to work first without the max. So what this means is we are looking at what we have inside here. We are looking at f of x minus fk of x in absolute value. And the good thing about this is we know exactly how fk look like, we know exactly like f of x look like, because fk is given by this expression and f of x is given by this expression. So we can simply take these two expressions and put in here. So f of x, this is what we have here. So this is, we have absolute value of 1 divided by 1 minus x, minus, and then the fk of x, this is 1 minus x to the power k plus 1 divided by 1 minus x. If you look at this, you can see that the denominator is the same. You have 1 minus x, you have 1 minus x. So what this means is that the one we have here will go out with the one we have here. So what is left is simply the minus and a minus, which gives us a plus. And then we have an x to the power k plus 1. And in the denominator, we have 1 minus x. Now, if you look at it, you can see we don't even need the absolute value because we are looking at x values from 0 up to a half. So all x values are positive. That means x to the power k plus 1 is certainly positive. And also 1 minus x will be a positive number because x is between 0 and a half. So this is the same as what we have here. And here you can actually make some estimates. Because, let me put it at the end here, we remember that we are only dealing with x that that are between 0 and a half. So that means the biggest value x to the power k plus 1 can take, this is exactly when we put in x to x equal to a half. So that means the maximum value we can get out in the counter, this is a half to the power k plus 1. What about the denominator? In order to get an estimate that turns this way, we want to estimate by something that is bigger, then we have to look at the denominator and find out what is the smallest value that we can get here. And the smallest value we can get for the denominator, this again happens when we put in a half. You see, if you put in 0, then we get 1 in the denominator, but if you put in a half, then we get 1 minus a half, which is a half. So the smallest value we can get here is a half. So that means everything can be estimated by a half to the power k plus 1 divided by a half. And then you can see this is the same as a half to the power k. So the statement that comes out here says that no matter which x you are looking at in the interval from 0 up to a half, then the absolute value of fx minus fk of x is smaller than or equal to a half to the power k. So the final estimate is that this is smaller than or equal to this. This holds for all x values. Therefore, it also holds for the x value that gives us the largest value on this side. So therefore, since all of these numbers are smaller than a half to the power k, then the maximum of these numbers will still be smaller than a half to the power k. So this means that max f of x minus fk of x, x in the interval 0 to a half, this is smaller than or equal to a half to the power k. And this maximum, we know exactly what this is, because by our definition, this is f minus fk measured in our infinity norm. So this infinity norm is smaller than or equal to a half to the power k. And then the question is, what happens when we let k go to infinity? Are we sure that the difference between f and fk goes to zero in norm? And the answer is yes, because a half to the power k goes to zero when k goes to infinity. So this goes to zero for k going to infinity. And since what we have here is smaller, then this is also forced to go to zero. So what we have proved here is that the sequence fk actually converges to f. In this norm space that we are dealing with, c, 0, and a half. Now, I will actually not tell you more today, but if you look in the book, you will see that there are some sections about what I call topology also. There's a section about topology in Rn, and there's a section about topology in norm vector spaces. And if you look at these sections, you will see that there are some topics that are called open sets, closed sets. And again, those of you who had Mathematics 3 will know these concepts. They will be new to all other of you. Actually, there are a few exercises today where you need the concepts of open and closed sets. And also one of the homework assignments will need closed sets. So those of you who know the language of open and closed sets will actually notice that what we have proved here is that we have a family of polynomials that converts to something which is not a polynomial. So you see, the FKs are by definition polynomials. The F is not a polynomial. So what we actually proved in this exercise is that there's a sequence of polynomials that converts towards something that is not a polynomial. And in the terms of closed sets, what this tells us is that the set of polynomials is not a closed subset of the set of continuous functions. So those of you who want to speak a little bit more about this, just contact me at the problem session, then we can discuss that. So, any questions? Otherwise, let's just meet at the problem session. Thank you.